For me, I mean, and for Ian in the first season, I was lucky enough to wear the Kingsguard outfit, which, when you see it up close, honestly, it is stunning. All the costumes are stunning. The attention to detail, so much of the detail you don't even see, but it is so perfect. Now, it was heavy. By season five, it kept getting heavier every season because they kept making it more ornate and more elaborate. So by the fifth season, it was 28 kilos.
You could barely walk.
It's about 4.5 stone. And I had to stand on the back of a boat coming into Braavos Harbour in 28 kilos of armour, which I think was probably the most terrifying moment of my life. But there's something about the costumes. You put them on and suddenly you're the Kingsguard.
Yeah,
it helps your performance so much.
Yeah.
And they are so vital, I think, to the look of the show and the success of the show.
You can't underestimate the value of costume. It gives you a real sense of character. But armour, the upper part of it is actually fiberglass.
No, it was only fiberglass when you wore it, chum.
Well,
they changed it to brass in season two.
All right, you got unlucky. It was fiberglass, and I have to say, the upper part was amazingly comfortable. Really was. It was lovely to wear. And it looked great. I was comfortable. The skirt, by contrast, which went down to mid-calf, was thousands, and it must have been thousands, of little leaves of brass. It weighed a ton. It pulled you down so that by the end of the day, I mean, your feet were tired because everything was sort of like being pulled down towards the ground. So, I mean, it's a shame because the best-looking part of it was actually the best bit to wear. The other bit was hard work.
Bathroom breaks were a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And don't do yourself an injury.
The brass leaves actually did curl up under the lights. So when you sat down, it was literally a pain in the ass.
The first meeting you ever have when you go into a series like that is with costume.
Yeah, you do. Yeah, you get measurements.
And I'd never seen anything like it. And you kind of knew from that, whatever you thought you were going into in Game of Thrones, and none of us did to begin with, I don't think. But the, when you saw those costumes and were fitted for them, you kind of went, oh, I see.
Mm.
Oh, it's going to be that good. Oh, you're spending that much
time. Yeah, yeah. And the thing that actually gave me that impression exactly was when I put on my Faith Militant tunic for the first time, and they put the chains across my chest and crossed them, and I went and they brought them out, and I realised the costume department was holding them both in two hands because they all were proper bits of iron. They were solid iron, and you put them on my shoulders and just and over the course of the day, once you take it off, you've just got marks on your body because they really imprint you, and that weight specifically when you wear it makes you go, right, you're going to just plug yourselves in, guys, because it really takes it. You makes take you very seriously.
I remember Roger Ashton Griffiths, who was Mace Tyrell, was talking to the costume department about his character, and he had this idea that in Highgarden, which was the Tyrell seat, that he had a private zoo. He just had this private zoo. And within a week, the costume department had his outfit embossed with elephant clasps. He looked at it, oh my God. And they were stunning. They were perfect.
It was the one thing you tried to pinch from the show, I
don't think. Yes, I don't think. Yes. I tried to pinch my chains.
The other wonderful thing, of course, about the series is that it wasn't a specific place, it wasn't a specific period. So in that sense, costume had free range, as did sets for that matter. You could go to whatever source for whatever location you wanted to do. So, you know, whether it was Mexico or whether it was China or whether it was Middle European or whatever, each and every kind of court could have its own sort of very specific design that was unique to it, but it wasn't bound by time and place. And that was wonderful freedom for the designers, you know, and they took full advantage of it, you know.
It's something that has come up more and more in the general media conversation, the way our industry has changed with the streaming services, the different platforms. But for all that, I believe at the moment that we're entering what I regard to be the golden age of television. I believe going to the cinema 10 or 15 years from now will be as specialised as going to the theatre today, because I believe more and more it will come into your home. the latest movies will come into your home. The television sets are getting bigger and they're getting cheaper. The sound systems, you have everything that you require. For me, Game of Thrones has set a benchmark. And it has set a benchmark in quality. It's no surprise to me to find out that the new series are being commissioned looking for the next Game of Thrones. I believe Game of Thrones has set a benchmark, and I believe it's very, very high. It's the production values, it's the scripts, the storylines, the acting, the attention to detail. Each episode is a movie in itself, and it's movie quality. I defy anybody to tell me they've seen anything better on television than season 6, episode 9, The Battle of the Bastards. It was the best thing I've ever seen. It was the best episode of television I have ever seen. And 20 years from now, people will be streaming Game of Thrones or watching Game of Thrones on whatever service they will get it on. And it will have the same impact 20 years from now as it has today. I'm absolutely certain of that.
The benchmark in terms of quality is very high, but they kind of create a problem, not just for themselves, but for anybody who follows hereafter. When you do this box set thing, it's almost like each and every episode has to be, you know, a surprise moment or a total shock. And Game of Thrones has pushed themselves on that front and done it very well. I mean, so many episodes now, it's like, what's going to happen this time? Where is this going to end? But there's a real pressure now on each and every show to somehow or another find a big out, a big challenge with each episode, so you go ways early, and that's tough. I mean, at some point, people are going to probably say we've got to start shying away from this. But for the moment, that's the way it's going.
You were talking about cliffhangers, and I think that was always the case with network shows, certainly in America, where almost every ad break has to have a cliffhanger. And I think with things like Game of Thrones, and because of companies like HBO and all the other companies that are doing similar work, it's less of that now. Yes, I mean, each episode, makes you want to watch the next, but it's not quite so obviously cheaply like, if we're going to get them back after the commercial break, we're going to have to... And you still watch network shows now, and you go... It's unbelievable how many cliffhangers in 1 hour they manage.
You have to write into it. But the thing about the nature of what TV is doing at the moment is that the public's appetite, their actual ability to consume the stuff they're given in whatever show they're watching, has just increased tenfold, because now that you've got the ability to be able to essentially stream any 10 episodes back to back. I mean, if you really were committed, you could watch 10 hours in a day. You could just bomb your way through it and you're done. You probably would regret it because you don't savor it that much, but you could do it. So what it means is that what has become, in Game of Thrones' case, 6 months worth of filming and footage is consumed in potentially a day or two. And it's in that sense, you can just eat so much television. It's just extraordinary. So it is a golden age of television, without any doubt. But it's also, it has to have a lot of energy to maintain itself. And there are so many shows out nowadays, and I'm addicted to a lot of them. I love House of Cards. I remember when it came out, I didn't realize until the most recent season came out, just quite how much I liked it, because it was gone in 2 days. I had work to do, but I didn't. I just watched it. So it's having an effect really on people, which is I think rather interesting.
Speaking personally as a parent, I have to say I am so delighted that you can watch 2 or 3 episodes of one thing at the same time, because all I get is Adventure Time, SpongeBob, and when I eventually get the kids to bed, that is when I get a chance to actually watch what I want to watch, or when I've got them to school in the morning. I do love the idea that there will be so much available to the viewer, and it can be consumed in 3-hour chunks or 2-hour chunks or 4-hour chunks. I do think it will increase the quality. I really strongly believe that. And I believe Game of Thrones, there's a reason why Game of Thrones has won more Emmys than any other show in history. It's that good. It really is that good. And just when you think they can't get any better than that, it gets better. And I think that will set a standard for the television shows to come, and that can only be good for the viewer. Yeah. That means quality television is on its way, because if it's not good enough quality, it will not be watched.
The final episode really was something that I think no one really knew. On paper, it was so explosive, literally, that you couldn't imagine how there were a million ways anyone could do it, but there are also 999,000 of them could have been ballsed up. And the one that we ended up with was thanks to pre-mentioned Miguel Sapochnik for preempting episode 10 with the Battle of the Bastards, which was probably, in all objectivity and humility, it's probably one of the most stunning battles I've ever seen. And I like the third Lord of the Rings film, but that was still just unbelievably brilliant, because so little of it was actually CGI'd. In other words, the impact of like cavalry charging into one another was actually done to a certain degree, and then all they did was take the isolated incident of the small number of cavalry they had and simply multiply it. So really, it wasn't as though they just went, right, we've got a field and we're just going to bring everything in through CGI. They actually did it. Which is another credit that has to be given to TV at the moment. It's not really trying to base so much of itself in realistic action as much as it can until a dragon comes marching in.
Proper filmmaking.
It's proper filmmaking. Way back when, things like Bonaparte, they really hired the whole Russian army to come in and just to on horseback and basically used thousands of men. But I think that the last episode for me, as far as sort of bits of television go, when I was filming the scene beneath the crypt when Lancel is trying to put out the wildfire, one of the things that I couldn't properly really foresee about how amazing it would be was because I didn't know what music they were going to use. And when you listened to the orchestra in that particular winding up towards the wildfire exploding, the music just creeps into your skin, and it totally blankets you in suspense, curiosity, and terror, actually, I think is the most important one. And I thought that it made the episode so much more powerful, going from everyone from Marjorie Tyrell knowing Cersei's up to something, to the High Sparrow, for the first time in the entire show, wonderful Jonathan Pryce, the first time we've ever seen him have doubt, and then even fear, and the music led us into that exposure. I thought that it was just revealed in the most brilliant way. The scene in itself, just before that, the wildfire goes off and we lose both ourselves dying it, and at least seven to eight other Game of Thrones characters are vanquished straight away. The scene itself, when I was dragging myself along the corridor, I mean, there was no CGI for that. That was a full-on underground catacomb in a Belfast castle. All of the lights for the bits of wildfire, no CGI. They were all just a chemical that shone in that way. When I got up to the candle and I was about to put out, supposedly, the candles, the crew had put down some chemicals that would ignite when I got close enough to it. And the first take, I said this when we were downstairs, the first take when they set off the fire, I got up to it and was within about a foot of this puddle, and someone clicked their fingers to suggest light the fire off camera, and the thing just right in front of my face. And the look on my face when I came back from not being in front of the fire was just. And I was totally taken aback, because that was the most real effect I'd ever seen. I don't know how I can do it enough credit. I just thought that it was wonderfully done. And I think that what that has set a precedent for season 7 being just such a clean and rather terrifying slate. You know, really it is. You know, everyone is now marching on King's Landing. You know, Daenerys is coming for us, and the White Walkers are coming down, and nothing is probably going to be able to stop them. Everything is now, for the first time in Thrones, given it's such a complicated show, it's now going to meet the nucleus. Going to be a nucleus at the centre of Game of Thrones.
The weird thing is,
and that's the thing about it. And that was a long-term bit of screenwriting that they have always been building towards. Yeah. And it, again, just it, you couldn't, it could not be more fitting of the word epic. It's epic.
Well, they've
it's
set enormous. Themselves big challenges, because we all believe we've been in battles significant already.
Yeah.
What's to come?
It is. I mean, what if the Battle of the Bastards end up looking like a kind of mild playground skirmish? Do you know what I mean? You know, a sort of sand castle. Exactly.
That is certainly the suggestions that are coming out of set, that there are things to come in season seven, and it's lovely because we are getting the strands coming back, coming together. I think I saw a poster for season seven, and the tagline was "The End Begins," which I thought was very, very clever.
That's very good.
Yeah. And it was extraordinary because a lot of people have been talking about how the season seven has, in fact, been split into two. So there will now be a season eight. There'll be seven episodes in season seven and six episodes in season eight. And the reason for that was that when HBO asked David and Dan at the end of season six how much longer they needed, David and Dan said 13 hours. They didn't say 12. They didn't say 14. They know exactly what they need. And I think it's a testament to both of them that they have everything.
Yeah, yeah.
They know exactly what they want.
Mm, down to a T. It's
a privilege to work for them.
I think it's almost impossible not to romanticise it in terms of what ending you want. You know, there is some sort of vision everyone has in mind. And, I mean, a lot of people have the idea of Daenerys Targaryen taking the Iron Throne and vanquishing all the White Walkers and long live the Queen. I find that a rather droll and sort of not a particularly interesting ending. It's too easy.
Easy.
George doesn't do easy. They don't do easy. So, yeah. You know, whatever it is, it won't be easy.
It was very strange because whenever the moment of Game of Thrones that has hit me the most was Hold the Door. No spoilers, but for those who have seen it, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Hold the Door broke my heart. And after it came out, George Martin said that it was one of three twists that he had still to do. What are the next two twists going to be? I have no idea. And that, I mean, you cannot second guess it. You cannot second guess where this could go. It could be Littlefinger. Mm. Anybody could sit on that throne at the end. There will be shocks before it all ends. And I personally have no idea where it's going to go now.
Yeah. People ask us, and you know, the only thing you can really say is just try to be a contrarian to yourself. If you want something and you think that's probably going to happen, reverse it in
its entirety. You can guarantee
it's not.
Reverse
it in its entirety, and you're probably closer to the answer, really. I have no idea. None of us do. Yeah. We're all dead. I believe Daenerys is going to die. I think that the Iron Throne is going to be destroyed. I think that I just don't think anything is. I think everything is going to change, but because it's too easy otherwise, isn't it? But who knows?
What has life been like after Game of Thrones, particularly now that you're no longer involved in the show?
Oh, I'll take this one first. Game of Thrones has completely changed my life and has completely changed my career. And I will be forever grateful to David and Dan for doing that for me. I am getting into rooms now. I'm getting jobs now that I wouldn't have had a chance of 5 years ago. It has completely upped my profile. And it's a calling card. If you walk into an audition room and the director and the producer are looking and say, 5 seasons of Game of Thrones, well, he can act. Now, is he right for the role? I don't know. But he can act because he was in 5 seasons of Game of Thrones. So it has been a phenomenal experience for me. It was awful to leave it. It broke my heart. I miss it terribly. I miss it dreadfully because when you're filming, you're a part of this incredible family. And it is. It's like an incredibly large, incredible, wonderful family. Everybody knows each other. Everybody does their job so incredibly well. From the person at the base of the pyramid to the person at the top of the pyramid. It's why the show is so good. It has transformed my life. And I'm grateful.
Yeah, I agree with that. Definitely, it's a calling card compared with whatever else you might have done before, simply because it's universally known and universally appreciated. So, you know, other than that, everything else has happened chance. You know, it, as you say, it opens doors and the rest is up to you, you know.
Mm. I agree. I mean, those words sum it up.
Yes, they do. I remember being very, very sad for the last day's filming. I was with Roger and we both went. Because it became an annual event. We used to go to Belfast.
It did. That was the thing.
And suddenly we didn't have to go to Belfast anymore.
There was a sort of seasonal routine to it, wasn't there? I remember arriving, and the first thing I would do without fail was I would listen to I Will Wait by Mumford & Sons. That was the song I associated with arriving back into Belfast City Airport.
Really?
And when I drove back there, I just finished a film called The Lodgers on Friday, and when I drove back through Belfast to get home from Donegal, I put on the song.
I have to say, as a native of Belfast, it's awfully refreshing to hear people say, "I can't wait to go to Belfast."
Well, you didn't used to hear that, let me tell you.
In that sense, it has been very good for Belfast.
It has been
too,
yeah,
it has given it much more of a cachet than it ever would have had.
Mm. It really has. It has changed Northern Ireland's economy. It has made Northern Ireland a centre of filmmaking. Mm. It has given us a new tourist industry that I would have to say, and I can say this because I come from Belfast, that is not associated with a disaster of one sort or another. It has done absolute wonders for our province and the economy and all the crew and plasters, electricians, hotels, restaurants, you name it, the trickle-down effect has been stunning and seismic.
And another thing, though, about just sort of the life of an actor, the great thing about a series like Game of Thrones, especially if you know that you're going to be in it for a while, is that we're all freelancers. So at the end of the day, you finish a job, where's the next one? You know?
Mm.
The great thing about doing something like that is it's a banker. For a few years at least, you can say, if nothing else, I know I'm doing that next year. That takes the pressure off next year a little
bit. Yeah, it does.
Everything else then is a bonus because you know you've got that.
Yeah.
But whenever that is gone, well, then you're back to what's out there.
You're back in the pool.
But having said that, the way our industry is now, the way the entertainment profession is now, Game of Thrones is a gift that keeps on giving. Here we are at a Comic-Con meeting the fans, you know, and we travel the world, we go to Comic-Cons, and it's just wonderful. Yeah.
We should give a shout-out. Actually, Comic-Cons are such fun to do. And for anyone watching this, you really should come along to them. They're the place where you can be yourself most in the world. The people are, without fail, absolutely lovely. They're joyous, and they're just a wonderful, wonderful bit of modern popular culture, and I recommend them to everyone.
Brilliant. We've had a great time over the last few years of the Comic-Cons. We really have.
Mm. And again, we meet up.
And
that's lovely as well.
It's like an old pals reunion for us.
I mean, which was even nicer is Ian and I never worked with each other on set.
Yeah.
There's so many people that you don't work with on set, and you meet them at events like this. It's like, hey!
And I get to come back, and I get to be with Ian. You know, it's great. And there's even Ian White who's hanging around. So I get the three Ians. It's fantastic.
You have to be called Ian.
I was going to say Eugene, but no, another time. Yeah, exactly.